Alright, so hi guys. I'm Jin Xi. I'm a student. I'm final year student at the Singapore University of Technology and Design. So these tips aren't gonna be very high level. I don't have that much experience, but hopefully you can learn something. And this is my exceedingly silly Slack handle and GitHub handle slash yeah. So I think one of the reasons I decided to speak today was because I was laboring under this blissful illusion that my school wouldn't have started yet. It turned out to be horribly mistaken. But, well, it's too late for that. So it's time for... It was supposed to be time for 5 random Ruby tips, but unfortunately I think I kind of went overboard while I was preparing for this talk. So I'm only going to give 3 and hopefully be able to go into more detail for each tip. Okay, so the first tip. A quibble rant about procs and lambdas. So when originally writing this tip, I was originally titled it A Quibble About Procs and Lambdas, but the more and more I researched into it, the more and more it became a rant, because I just grew more and more flabbergasted about, you know, this, and I think you'll understand why as I go through it. Okay, so the age-old question, proc versus lambda. This question has been asked and answered 10,001 times on like Stack Overflow, on people's blogs, everywhere. Okay, everywhere. So like, why do people have to keep explaining this over and over again to themselves, to other people? And then like, you know why, right? Naturally, you ask why. What's this funny thing in Ruby? So at first, I thought, you know, I'm just a beginner at programming. Maybe there's some deep significance difference between procs and lambdas that I'm not just quite getting, but I'm too lazy to figure out now. So I just put it on my list of stuff to understand Ruby. So recently I became not lazy, and I realized it's actually a very stupid, mundane, very confusing difference. In my opinion, I think it's a bad design quirk in Ruby. I think Ruby violates something I like to call a don't make me remember things principle. So this is actually taken from this 8-flight blog post, which talked about, you know, when you're designing an interface for people, like let's say a language that programmers are gonna use, you don't make people remember needless, unnecessary things. So, and I think the difference between procs and lambdas is one of those needless, unnecessary things that somehow Ruby, you know, has. So, the gist of this tip is procs have tricks. Tricks are nasty things. Say no to tricks and say yes to lambda, okay? So, first off, what do I mean by a proc? Firstly, I'm going to say that I want to just introduce, like, slightly, I don't know, new terminology. I don't want to say proc versus lambda. I'm going to call it proc versus lambda proc. You see why soon. So what are procs? Proc are basically instances of the proc class. So there's a proc class in Ruby, right? So procs are just instances of this proc class that you create with kernel proc or proc.new, right? And they actually do the same thing. Apparently in Ruby 1.8.7, they didn't do the same thing, which is, I don't know why, but now they do the same thing, thankfully. And then lambda procs, so I'm going to call lambda procs what most people call lambdas. These are also instances of the proc class that you create with kernel lambda or with the rocket hash, rocket symbol shorthand. So let me explain why I'm calling it lambda proc instead of lambda. So I call them lambda procs because, like I said, they're just instances of the proc class, and they're just instances of the proc class with something that seems like a lambda flag set to true. And in fact, so if you look at here, my lambda, when I print it out, you actually see, I don't know if you can see it, you can actually see that it's a proc object with a lambda down there. And in fact, the proc class exposes a lambda question mark method, which returns true if it's a lambda. So they're basically proc objects with this lambda flag set to true. So that's kind of why like I'm trying to remind myself of this by calling them lambda procs. Right, so what do the docs say? The docs say that this predicate method, lambda, is a predicate for what they call the tricks. These are nasty things, let me just say first. So it returns true if no tricks apply. Okay, so what are these awesome tricks? And let me reiterate again, these tricks are not good, so I think you should just be using lambdas instead of procs. Okay, so let's look at trick number one. I have a proc, takes 2 arguments. I do some fancy stuff with the first argument, multiplied by the second argument. Somewhere far, far away in my code, this happens all the time. Programmers make silly typos. I forget to pass in the second argument. What do I get? Obviously, I get an error. But what kind of error do I get? I get a type error. No implicit conversion from nil to integer. And then you're like, okay, I should have expected to get an argument error, but I don't. Again, this is not very helpful. It's kind of cryptic and unhelpful. But if you do this, the same thing with lambdas, then yes, you get something sane, you get an argument error. It tells you that you pass in the wrong number of arguments. Okay, that makes sense. But even worse than cryptic errors that procs give you are errors that are swallowed up. They fail silently. So what if I have a proc like this? I take the language conjunction object and I print this sentence. I like language conjunction, I don't like object. So a correct invocation would be something like passing Ruby, but tricks. So I like Ruby, but I don't like tricks. And you shouldn't like them too. Now, some guy unfamiliar with my proc forgets that he's supposed to pass in a conjunction. So he passes in Ruby and tricks. And what do I get? I like Ruby, tricks I don't like. And this is actually grammatical, but it's oxymoron, right? It doesn't make sense. So, this error fails silently. Like, it's not going to throw any error for you. Because what is happening is that this proc object is helpfully providing a nil argument, nil to your missing arguments. And so that nil just gets swallowed up. And that is basically trick number one. Procs provide nil for missing arguments. And to me, this, I don't know why this would be useful. Because this is just going to confuse me as a programmer. Like, if I miss all my arguments, I expect to get argument error. I don't expect it to fill it, my parameters with nil. But it gets better than that. Oh no. Okay, sorry, you saw that already. But yeah, so let's say I have another proc. Now it takes A and B, and it expects A and B to be arrays, right? So I concatenate the arrays. A correct invocation, I pass in two arrays. But then again, I also forget to pass in my second argument, and now I don't get the argument error. I get a no method error, undefined method concat for fixNum. And of course, if you use a lambda, you get something sane with like argument error again. And you saw the trick just now. The trick is that it automatically expands array arguments if the extra arguments to fill. And again, this really baffles me. I'm like, okay, why do I need this? Because if I really wanted to expand array arguments, I could just, you know, explicitly splat my array. But yeah, super helpful. So yeah, I don't understand this behavior. If anyone understands why this is useful, you know, aside from confusing beginners, then please let me know. So because Ruby introduces all this additional complexity with tricks, now we have to talk about trick preservation. Okay, what do I mean? So we know we can do this. We can use the ampersand operator to convert procs and lambdas into blocks. Which also means I can do this. I can pass that converted block back into lambda or proc. So my question to you guys is lambda and my proc tricksy? Who thinks yes? No one? Okay, is proc and my lambda tricksy?
Yes.
Yes. Who thinks proc and proc from meta object tricksy? So you can convert meta objects to procs. So who thinks the last one is tricksy? So everything is not tricksy. You think it's tricksy? Okay, so the answer is tricksy, not tricksy, not tricksy. Okay, so you might be thinking, what's the reason? My proc was originally a tricksy proc. You pass it back to lambda, it's still tricksy. Once tricksy, forever tricksy, sadly. My lambda was not tricksy. It didn't have those funny tricks, right, that I showed just now. You pass it back to proc and reconstruct it to a proc object. It's still going to be a lambda proc. It's not going to be tricksy. The same with procs from meta objects. So proc from meta objects get converted into lambda procs, right? They're not tricksy. And if you pass them back to proc, they're just still going to be not tricksy. So you're like, okay, I see a pattern here. I'm like, does the ampersand operator always preserve tricks? Obviously, from the question mark, you can tell that it's not always the case. So I leave this to you. If you're interested, go and check out the docs. It almost always preserves tricks. And it's kind of funny when I read that part of the docs, I'm really like, it's kind of like an open admission that this is all unnecessary complexity, but okay. Yeah, so those were the tricks. But we also know, most of you should also know that there's a difference in return semantics for procs and lambda procs. And the reason for this, I think, is because, you know, normally when we deal with procs or lambda procs, we think that we're actually dealing with full-fledged function objects, right? These are handles on a block statements you can pass around. And yeah, it's completely natural to think so. So for example, if I do this with procs, I have a method where I nest calls to procs. Normally you would expect, each of the procs return. And normally you would expect, if I call this method, for it to print something like first proc, second proc method. So the first proc returns its value, then the second proc calls the first proc, then it returns its value, and then the method returns. So that's what sane people expect. But the proc is not sane, so the proc returns immediately from the method. Then you're like, okay. But lambdas, they behave just as expected, right? So the first lambda returns, then the second lambda returns, and then your method returns. So some of them, last time I read about this difference in return semantics, I was like, okay, maybe I just have to accept it as it is. But I didn't really understand, why is this different? So I realized recently that the difference arises because you can't actually return from procs. What are you returning from when you return from a proc? You're returning from the enclosing function, you're not returning from the proc. So in fact, if you do something like this, you try to return from a proc in the top level, this doesn't work, you get a local jump error. You can't return from something that's not a function. And that's the key point. A proc is actually not a function object that you think it is, that most people, that I assumed it was a function object, but apparently it's not. So you can't return from something that's not a function, so you cannot return from a proc. You can only return from procs when they are enclosed by a function. So this is why this last method, you can actually return from this proc. So this is actually kind of dangerous because we can try to return from procs when it's actually not possible. So let me tell you again, lambda procs are the ones that are sane, they return in an expected manner. So lambda procs are your real function objects, so which leaves the question, so what the hell are procs? So I kind of figure out from all this explanation that maybe procs are kind of like this weird halfway between blocks and full-fledged function objects. So you can do a lot of stuff that you can do the procs that you can't do the blocks. For example, blocks don't have a name, right? Procs have a name, you can pass them around. You can try to return from procs when you actually can't. A block is kind of static. If you put it in a function, it will only ever be there. But procs, you can kind of try to move it around, move it outside a function and try to return when it can't return. So that's dangerous. And of course, you can shoot yourself in the foot with all those fancy tricks that I showed you just now. So I realized more and more as I thought about this, this is kind of an understatement. Procs are more like these super-powered killer zombie mutant blocks, and I don't know why you want to use them, basically. And so I don't know whether, I don't know if anyone can convince me why I want to ever use procs, but I think you should always ever, you basically always want to use lambda procs, from what I understand about what procs and lambdas do. But the sad fact is, I don't know why Ruby wants to introduce procs. I don't really understand. I don't really know why. Like, if anyone has everyone knows why, anyone has talked to Ruby Core, why does Ruby have procs? Please let me know. I basically think that you always want lambda procs instead, but Ruby doesn't want to help you because, okay, we saw the ampersand operator just now to convert procs to blocks. We also know we can do the conversion the other way. So we can, and this is a very common pattern, we have a method that takes in a block and it converts that block to a proc with the ampersand. So the golden question is this a tricksy, is the converted block a tricksy proc or not tricksy proc? Any guesses? I see some strange faces. Okay, yeah. The sad thing is it is a tricksy proc. It's the proc that does all the really weird stuff. And this pattern is very common, and I think sometimes this can give rise to unexpected behavior of people who don't really understand what's the difference happening between procs and lambda procs. And the sad thing is, like I said, the ampersand preserves tricksiness. So once you're tricksy, you're forever tricksy. So once your block is converted to a tricksy proc, you're never going to get back a pure, nice lambda proc ever. And yeah, this is a real issue that I found. I mean, it's quite old, but the issue, you guys can look at it if you're interested, but this issue arose because people are trying to return from procs when you can't return from procs. So they were getting local jump error. So originally, they were passing a block to some active record callback. And originally, that block was evaled in, was like class, inv- like, I think it was instance evaled into a method. So methods, you can return from them, fine. But after that, they change active record or something, and then they stop instance evaling stuff. They just change them to procs and called the procs. But these procs were tricksy procs, and you cannot return from tricksy procs. So everything broke. Okay. So the fix was to pass in the block, not as a plain block, but to pass it in as a lambda converted to a block. So if you convert the block to a lambda, and you convert that block back into a proc, it's going to be a lambda proc. Okay. So yeah, I think this can cause definitely can cause bugs. So yeah, to summarize everything, I composed this litany for you. So say no to tricks, say yes to lambda. Say no to zombie mutant blocks, say yes to the true function objects. And Do not return from blocks and mutant blocks. Okay, so this has to be qualified. So obviously, if you know that your block is within a function, then yes, feel free to return, because you obviously know that return is returning from the function. It's not returning from the block. It doesn't make sense to return from blocks, right? But the thing is, people think that you're returning from a function when you're returning from a proc, but you're not. Okay, procs are not function, are not full-fledged function objects. Okay, so say no to kernel proc and proc.new. Say yes to kernel lambda and the rocket syntax. And thankfully, Ruby made it very easy to use rocket syntax. So, you know, go ahead and use it. Type less. So say no to tricksiness. Say yes to sanity. And the last one, I just throw my hands up in there. Yeah. Yeah, so that was tip number one. A bit of a rant. Sorry. Yeah, this is why I cut down the three tips. Okay, moving on. So tip number two. Okay, so yeah, I'm a Singaporean. Yeah. And Singaporeans are supposed to like our curry. We like our curry so much that we use it to fan our, you know, I don't know, depending on how you look at it, either xenophobia or national pride. And we even write plays about curry, right? So I realized recently that as a programmer, I have even more reason to like my curry. And then for those of you who maybe are not exposed to functional programming or super new to functional programming like me, and who grew up in a place where curry sounds more like something you put in your stomach than your code, you'll be looking at this curry chicken and you're like, what's she talking about? Okay. So it turns out that function currying is some this concept from functional programming. And in Ruby, you can actually, there's some, Ruby actually supports some of these functional programming tricks. So there's actually a curry method on the proc, on proc and method, proc and method classes. So what is function currying? So I just blatantly ripped this from Wikipedia. Currying is the technique of translating the evaluation of a function that takes multiple arguments into evaluating a sequence of function, each with a single argument. So currying is related to, but not the same as partial application. Okay, so a bit hard to digest. Let's look at some nice symbols. So first, I have my function f takes x, y, z, three arguments, and returns w. If I curry this function, I'm basically going to get a function that returns a function. So the curried function takes one argument, it returns another function. That return function also takes one argument, it returns another function. And that last function takes one argument, finally evaluates to the number. Okay, so that's function currying. And this is now terminology is arity, basically the number of arguments that your function takes. So curried functions have arity one, they only take one argument. Then what about partial application? So partial application is a related concept. So you have fyz, fxyz again. So if you partially apply x, y onto that function, you're basically binding the first two arguments x, y to some value. You're binding the first two parameters to some value. And then you get a function that takes in one argument and returns, finally, with reduced arity. That means it takes in less lower norm arguments than the original function. And that function finally returns its value. And the arity of the partially applied function, so the number of arguments it takes, is it depends on how many arguments you initially bind. So, but in the end, it's reduced. The arity is reduced. Okay, so this seems to be very common, like on internet, like currying and partial application, they're usually almost conflated, like referred to similarly. And I think the reason for this is, I mean, I haven't been using this that much myself, but I think the reason for this is because in languages that support currying, you can actually do partial application with curried functions. So let's take a look at currying in Ruby. Okay, so I already explained why I'm only ever going to use lambdas. So I declare my lambda, it takes three arguments, A, B, and C. So normally when I invoke this lambda, I'm just going to pass in three arguments. So in this case, I pass in 1, 1, 1, evaluates to 3. But if I curry my lambda, I can actually basically invoke, I can basically invoke it three times. So I pass it one argument each time. So I lambda.curry 1.1.1, that eventually also evaluates to 3. But what is happening in between all these invocations? So lambda.curry itself returns another lambda, right? And this lambda is a curried lambda. So when I invoke that curried lambda with one argument, I'm basically binding the first parameter to that first argument. And that returns me another curried lambda. So that's actually partial application. I'm partially applying that lambda. I'm binding the first parameter to an argument. And then I can do this, I chain this until I pass in enough arguments, and then my curried lambda finally evaluates. Right, so when my lambda originally took three arguments, when I finally pass in those three arguments, it can finally evaluate. And you don't actually even have to call these only pass in one argument at a time. So like I said just now, currying, when curried functions, they should only have arity one. But actually the Ruby curry method actually supports, you know, direct partial application. So I can actually pass in more than one argument straight away. So if I pass in lambda.curry.1,1, I'm basically binding the first two parameters to 1 and 1. So I get a function that only takes in one argument finally. Yeah, and I have to rant about procs again. They have some very weird behavior when it comes to currying. So apparently if procs, you can pass in a argument to the curry method, which doesn't really make sense to me. So apparently if you pass in one to the curry, the curry proc will try to evaluate after you only pass in one argument. So I have this proc that originally takes three arguments, and I try to, and then I curry it and say that you should evaluate after I pass you one argument. So I pass the curry proc one argument, and then it tries to evaluate. Obviously, it's gonna fail. So I don't really know why I would need this. And then you can also pass it. You can also ask it to curry to evaluate only after a number of arguments that's greater than the number of arguments it actually needs. So if you pass in 4 to curry, and then you call 1 3 times, it doesn't evaluate yet. But then if you pass in another argument, then it finally evaluates. But the final argument doesn't affect the evaluated result anyway, so I don't really know why you need this. So if you try to do this with lambdas, obviously there'll be an error thrown, and I think that should be the expected result. So basically you should never call curry with an argument. You don't need it anyway. Alright, so what about currying in the real world? So the example I'm going to show you doesn't really use Ruby's built-in curry, but it's a application of the concept of currying. So I think it's kind of cool to look at. Okay, so this is actually from the dry logic gem. So this is the gem that allows you to do predicate logic, and it's actually the basis of this gem called dry validation. It's a gem used for rich validations. So this rule class defines a curry method. So you pass in some arguments to this curry method, and then it combines the new arguments with some original arguments that were stored. They are stored in this instance. So this args here is actually a accessor for arguments that are stored in this instance. And so obviously, if the number of arguments arity is not correct, then you raise an argument error. If not, it evaluates this branch. And what this does is actually returns a new instance of this rule class with the combined arguments. So this is actually a concept of currying, and this is useful because sometimes you cannot pass all the arguments to your function straight away. So for example, so you actually see them use the curry method here. So this predicates greater than basically returns this this object, this instance, which can be curried. So this returns a greater than predicate. So you pass in first the first argument to this predicate object. You pass in 18. So 18 is the value that you compare this greater than to. But you don't have the data you need to want to compare to yet. So you pass in this argument first, and then when you have the actual data, so in this case the actual data being the user's age, then the greater than function will actually evaluate. So that is one real world case of function currying. Yeah, but this is not using Ruby's built-in curry methods, but it's basically the same concept. Okay, that's all for currying. So the last one is kind of like a more productivity tool tip. So Vim, universal ctext/RipperText+Ruby. The main thing here is actually not Vim or Ruby, it's actually ctext. So how many of you actually have used ctext? Okay, so yeah, so some of you have heard of it. So basically what this allows me to do is have IDS code navigation, in my editor. And let me just show you how it, actually you saw me kind of using it just now. So when I was trying to navigate this dry logic gem, I actually have this text file. This is generated by C-Text, and Vim has built-in tagging support. But of course, if you use other, like, lots of text editors also have built-in tagging support, so you can use C-Text with whatever plugins that your data support. Yeah. So I can actually jump to the specific text with some key bindings in Vim. So if I'm curious about this module, I can jump to it. And just now I jumped to the curry function. And this is very useful for navigating your own projects. And there are several Vim plugins as well as RBNV plugins and gems that allow you to not only generate text for your current project, but generate text for the gems included in your project. So you can basically jump to the gem source, right? And this is very useful when you need to debug stuff. And I found this super useful when I was... So I'm using Trailblazer cells in my Rails project, and this is for Vue models, but I had to debug a lot of stuff for this because some of the stuff in cells doesn't really play well with Rails. And it was very helpful for me to be able to jump straight into my gem source whenever I needed to find out stuff. So I can basically just jump into a gem source and see what stuff's happening. Yeah. Yeah, and I mean, previously I was actually like using GitHub to read people's like gem code, which is okay. It was really terrible. Like, I didn't want to read code after that. It was so excruciating, especially in Ruby because it's OO, right? A lot of indirection, a lot of delegation. You jump a method like methods calling methods. So I found this super helpful because you can just jump straight to the method definitions right away, and it made reading code so much easier and made debugging code so much faster. So okay. Just go through quickly what the individual components. So universal C-Text. So the original C-Text program was generated text files for only C, like C source and headers. Then there came exuberant C-Text, but this is the newest version of this was only in 2009. So universal C-Text is the currently actively maintained implementation, so you should use that instead of exuberant C-Text. For some reason or another, every single blog post out there about Vim and C-Text always asks you to install exuberant C-Text, so don't do that. Go to Universal C-Text GitHub repo and install it. There's a tab for homebrew if you're on a Mac. There's you can build from source if you're on Linux. Yeah. So use Universal C-Text. But the thing is, because on Ruby, we're using Ruby, right? Universal C-Text, it does. Exuberant C-Text didn't have a very good Ruby parser. It was written in C. Universal C-Text does a better job, but it still misses out on some things. And one thing that I find that was really bad for missing out was aliases. So there was one time I was going through like action view source and I was trying to find this method, but when I opened my tag file, it was not there. I was like, where's this phantom method? I can't find it. So apparently it was actually aliased and exuberant C-Text was not picking it up. So universal C-Text also doesn't pick up aliases, unfortunately, but there's a gem called Ripper Text. So Ripper is the built-in Ruby parser. So Ripper Text, so obviously it parses Ruby better than whatever parser is Universal C-Text using. So you can actually install this gem and use it to generate your text instead of Universal C-Text. Okay. So Vim, for those who use Vim, well, you have tagging support out of the box, you have nice key bindings, jump to any text, or you can get a list of matching text, or you can pop from your text stack. So super handy. Okay, so TLDR, what do I install? I want this super awesome code navigation stuff right away. So your system, you need Universal C-Text, to generate generate C-Text, obviously, and the Tim Pope, the maker of plugins, has written a lot of plugins. One of them is RBNV C-Text. So this will generate C-Text for your Ruby standard library automatically on install. As for gems, so if you want better text, use Ripper Text, right? And there's also a gem called Gem Ripper Text, which will automatically generate text for all your gems, all your gems on install. So you don't have to manually go to your gem directory and generate the text. And this is what allows me to jump to my gem source. So Vim bundle sets the text to include text for gems in your current bundle. So so Vim has this text variable that tracks that basically lists all the tag files for your project. So Vim bundler sets the text to include the text for the relevant gems that use in your project. So this is super useful. If not, I wouldn't be able to jump to my gem source straight away. Vim RBNV sets the text to include the standard library text as well. And finally, last one I'm using is tag bar. So this creates a nice tag bar that allows you to scroll through your project. This is super useful for when you have super long files. So this is basically tag bar. So obviously, this class is not very big, but obviously when you're scrolling through like very large, very complicated source files, this can be quite useful. Yeah. So yeah, that was my three tips. So thank you guys. Yes. Any questions?
Can you generate tags for dynamically defined methods?
Dynamically defined methods.
If I use defined method, like for example, I define five methods with almost the same body but different name, I use defined method.
I doubt it because it's just basically using a parser to read your file. So I don't think it's possible to detect stuff on runtime. Yeah, that's generated on runtime. Yeah. But I mean, I think it's pretty good already. Like, yeah, compared to reading code on GitHub. Okay.
No questions, so thank you, Jin Xi, once again.